I took some time with some of our young people this morning because we must understand that children are not a captive audience for church. What does that mean? That means that in the year 2017, there are a number of things, people, places that are competing for the allegiance and time of our children. Some folks say, well, they should just want to go to church. You must have revisionist history about when you were 10, or 8, or 7. So we must continue to encourage them at every turn. Love them every moment. For they, if Jesus should tarry, they will sit where we sit now. They will preach these sermons in years to come. They will give their tithes and offerings, and it won't be money that you gave them to give. They'll have their own paycheck with their own social security number. Giving is a learned action to give bountifully. So we thank God for them. I thank God for all the ministers that are up here, amen, and all those that are out there, and Minister Smith. It just amazes me that this brother, our intern from Palmer Seminary, he just jumps right on the drums. I know I say it's just amazing. And it never ceases to amaze me because there's plenty of y'all like that. You may not be able to play the drums, but you got a gift that you've been sitting on for a while. It's that secret gift that you don't want anybody else to know unless they ask you to do something. Amen. So we continue to thank God for all of you. Our text this morning is found in 2 Kings chapter 4. The portion of scripture is pretty long this morning, so lock in with me, all right? 2 Kings chapter 4, we'll begin reading at verse 8. I'm reading from the New American Standard Version. Now there came a day when Elisha passed over to Shunem, where there was a prominent woman, and she persuaded him to eat food. And so it was, as often as he passed by, he turned in there to eat food. She said to her husband, "Behold, now I perceive that this is a holy man of God passing by us continually. Please let us make a little walled chamber, upper chamber, and let us set a bed for him there, and a table and a chair and a lampstand, and it shall be when he comes to us that he can turn in there." One day he came there and turned into the upper chamber and rested. Then he said to Gehazi, his servant, "Call this Shunammite." And when he had called her, she stood before him. He said to him, "Say now to her, 'Behold, you have been careful for us with all this care. What can I do for you? Would you be spoken for to the king or to the captain of the army?'" And she answered, "I live among my own people." So he said, "What then is to be done for her?" And Gehazi answered, "Truly, she has no son, and her husband is old." He said, "Call her." When he had called her, she stood in the doorway. Then he said, "At this season next year, you will embrace a son." And she said, "No, my lord, O man of God, do not lie to your maidservant." The woman conceived and bore a son at that season. The next year, as Elisha had said to her, when the child was grown, the day came that he went out to his father, to the reapers. He said to his father, "My head, my head." And he said to his servant, "Carry him to his mother." When he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her lap until noon, and then he died. She went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God and shut the door behind him and went out. Then she called to her husband and said, "Please send me one of the servants and one of the donkeys that I may run to the man of God and return." He said, "Why will you go to him today? It is neither a new moon nor Sabbath." And she said, "It will be well." Amen. Then she saddled a donkey and said to her servant, "Drive and go forward. Do not slow down the pace for me unless I tell you." So she went and came to the man of God to Mount Carmel. When the man of God saw her at a distance, he said to Gehazi, his servant, "Behold, there is a Shunammite. Please run now to meet her and say to her, 'It is well with you, it is well with your husband, is it well with the child?'" And she answered, "It is well." When she came to the man of God to the hill, she caught hold of his feet, and Gehazi came near to push her away. But the man of God said, "Let her alone, for her soul is troubled within her. And the Lord has hidden it from me and has not told me." Then she said, "Did I ask for a son from my Lord? Did I not say, 'Do not deceive me'?" Then he said to Gehazi, "Gird up your loins and take my staff in your hand and go your way. If you meet any man, do not salute him. And if anyone salutes you, do not answer him. And lay my staff on the lad's face." The mother of the lad said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." And he arose and followed her. Then Gehazi passed on before them and laid the staff on the lad's face. And there was no sound or response, so he returned to meet him and told him, "The lad has not awakened." When Elisha came into the house, behold, the lad was dead and laid on his bed. So he entered and shut the door behind them both and prayed to the Lord. And he went up and lay on the child and put his mouth on his mouth and his eyes on his eyes and his hands on his hands. And he stretched himself on him, and the flesh of the child became warm. Then he returned and walked in the house once back and forth, and went up and stretched himself on him. And the lad sneezed 7 times, and the lad opened his eyes. He called Gehazi and said, "Call the Shunammite." So he called her, and when she came into him, he said, "Take up your son." Then she went in and fell at his feet and bowed herself to the ground, and she took up her son and went out. Thus ends the reading of our scripture this morning. For the next few moments, friends, I will share with you from the subject, "Nevertheless, she persisted." Nevertheless, she persisted. When I first started preaching, Sister Jackie, I got a lot of advice from a lot of different people about what I should do, how I should preach, and how I should conduct myself. Whenever a lot of people give you advice, especially advice that you did not ask for, you have to make sure that you are able to remember what is necessary and put aside what is not. One thing that I will always remember is an older pastor who told me, if in ever doubt, make sure that you read a nice long text. So even if you don't say anything, the people still got the word of God. That has worked for me. Nevertheless, she persisted. If you've ever had a goal in life, if you ever believed that you could be something, could do something that no one else thought you could or be, there will come a moment, Sister Jazz, when you will have to ask yourself the question, will I give in now? Will I stop because what I am seeing is telling me a different story? What I am hearing is telling me all the questions that I have come up from the inside. There will come a moment, a day of reckoning, when we will have to decide, just how bad do we want it? Just how bad do we want the successes that we've dreamed of so many years? Just how much is the burning desire on the inside of ourselves? Or is it just we've given lip service to what we saw on the television screen? For everybody wants what everyone has when it looks as if it is glamorous. That is half the reason we watch many of the awards show, to see what they are wearing on the red carpet. That's half the reason that we watch and read and make sure that we surf the internet, for we want to be a part, a member, someone, a companion of those who seem to be living a life that is greater than ours. But what we don't see are the nights of tears and the difficulty that it took to get to where they are right now. What we don't see are those moments of indecision and those times of ever coming questions that say, can I actually do it? That is why it's important that you have some folks in your corner that are not always detractors, but that are supporters. Make sure you know who is around you, who is in your circle. And I've said this before and I'll say it again, some of us need to cut some folks off. And we'd be amazed on the bounds and leaps and growth that will take place once we get those folks out of the circle that are always telling us the reasons that we can't.
Amen.
Instead of sowing into us the reasons that we can. Because when it happens, when the obstacle there is there, and when those proverbial mountains come in our way, we will then look back to what the old folks say to say that I had some mountain-moving faith.
Yes, yes.
See, mountain-moving faith is faith that you believe can move mountains.
Yes.
But see, there's been a misnomer in the world today that all of a sudden mountain-moving faith has to actually be the size of a mountain. But that's not what the scriptures say at all. The scriptures say that if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, then you can speak to the mountain and tell the mountain to be thou removed and cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in your heart, then you shall have what you say. See, mountain moving faith isn't as big as a mountain, but where God is, it can make a mustard seed seem like it's a mountain.
Yes. Yes.
Nevertheless, she persisted. I was talking to some pastor friends of mine this week, and there are many who began to think about what happened last week in the political landscape. You don't need me to tell you what took place. She was warned. She was given an explanation. But then she persisted. And there are many across this land right now that are preaching that same subject, but they have substituted a he for the she. See, they don't want to talk about this idea that she persisted. But let me tell you something. If the only thing you're ever going to learn is from a man, then I tell you right now, you're going to miss out on some great things. Because there's some things that women can teach us that men can't teach us. There's no man alive that can teach us what it was to have Jesus as a baby. But Mary, sure enough, came through with what it was to have Jesus as a baby. There's some things that women can teach us that men cannot, and that's why we remember today that she persisted, that she kept going, that she did not give in, and that is what we remember. Black History Month, and you know what happened to Black History Month. We talk about the same three folks. Martin Luther King Jr., Frederick Douglass, and Harriet Tubman. That's it. One got us out of slavery, and then one helped us get some rights, and then one helped us get some more rights, and it all stopped when King died. No more Black history. If it's the truth, say amen.
Amen.
But I tell you, my history books tell me that as the president of the National Council for Negro Women, this woman was often met with resistance and obstacles when she was advocating alongside men that for the full inclusion of women, and more specifically women of color, throughout society. There were those that said it would never happen. There were those that said you ought to know your place. There were those that said you ought to sit down. But Dorothy Hite, she persisted.
Amen.
As a founding member of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in 1960, there were those who warned her that your actions will end up being the death of you. There were those who said what you are engaging down at the Woolworth counter will end up being the end of your life, as they came to her with their own fears. Diane Nash persisted.
Amen.
As she prepared to take the stage at the 1964 Democratic Convention, those in high places were telling her, this is what you ought to say to the people. They advised her not to speak that graphically about the injustices that were taking place in the great state of Mississippi. They told her, don't shed too much light on the situation. But I tell you right now, folks don't want too much light, because when the light goes on, darkness has to go. Oh, you know what it is. When the lights go on, things start running away. So when Fannie Lou Hamer stood up to the podium, she began to talk in great detail about what is going on in the states that are called these United States. They said that she'd get in trouble, but I tell you, Brother Torrance, she persisted.
All right.
And she asked the age-old question that rings even true right now. Is this America? There have been countless men and women, my brothers and sisters, who have throughout the course of time persisted in doing what they knew was the right thing to do. See, doing the right thing always isn't sexy. It's not always progressive. Doing the right thing might put you at odds with some folks. But at one point or another, we have to ask ourselves the question, will we persist in doing what God has called us to do? Dave Chappelle said, you're not going to use me. He persisted. Martin King said, you can't buy me. He persisted. And the Shunammite woman said, you can't distract me. In the text we see on the eastern end of the valley of Jezreel, on the southwest slope of the hill of Moreh, here we meet the Shunammite woman. I wish I would have known her name, but at least I can call her by what her origin was. Other times, people just want to name you according to what your affliction is. They try to say that that is what encompasses you. That's why we say the woman with the issue of blood. I can't imagine anyone that wants to be defined by the blood that comes out of their body. They try to name you by the affliction that you may be dealing with at that time, but at least I get to call her the Shunammite woman. At least I get to give her respect and honor to who she was as a person. So the text moves as follows. We see Elisha. We know who Elisha is. He is the protege of Elijah. And you remember when Elijah was getting ready to leave, and he said, Elisha, why do you keep following me? And Elisha said, I don't want all the things that everyone else wants, but what I do want is a double portion of what you got. What I do want is a double portion of God. That would bless some folks if they really got in that understanding that said, it's not about all the things that you see on the outside, but sometimes you have to yearn for what's on the inside. I know sometimes say, I want the car that the pastor has, and I want this that the preacher has, or the deacon has, or the choir member has. But I tell you, you need to be around some folks that you can say, I want a double portion of what's on the inside. Because what's on the inside, the world didn't give it to you, and the world can't take it away. So here we are on the plains of Jezreel, and we meet Elisha, and he has been doing good for much of his life. If you read 2 Kings, you'll see that he did many of the things that his predecessor had done. Raising the dead, helping out the people who don't have enough, making food show up where there wasn't any food. Just before here in the text, we see that Elisha was able to allow oil to flow so that a woman and her children would not die. We see him walking. He's walking and he's going back and forth, but the amazing thing about the text says, Sister Gloria, is that there was a woman who saw him and knew that there was something different about him. The text doesn't say he said anything. The text doesn't say he stopped. The text doesn't say anything. It just said he was walking back and forth, and there was a woman who looked and said, I believe that there's something different about this man. Oh, that's a question for you. If I didn't say anything else today, that would be enough. When people see you, when people see you, do they see that there's something different on the inside? Or do you do a good job of camouflage? Hallelujah. When you get on the set of the bus and you camouflage like a chameleon and make it fit right in like everybody else. Or is there something different about you? The way that you walk and the way that you talk and the way that you carry yourself. Do people see the God in you?
Amen.
That's what happened in the text. And she saw this man and she did something that was amazing, was that she offered her home to him, but she persisted. See, people say, well, what's the big deal about that? Well, later on in the text, you realize what her situation had been. She had been living and married, but yet she would not have been able to have children. And in that time, you realize that if you did not have children, people would say all types of things about you. They would talk about you, and they would look at you with a downward look. But see, she didn't allow other folks to define who she was or allow them to put her into a cage. No, she said, even though I don't have any children, I'm still going to find an opportunity to bless someone else. And some of us have been sitting on our capacity to bless someone else because of something that happened to us long time ago. We say, well, it happened to me, and so therefore, I'm not going to help anybody else. But she tells us that you got to keep on living.
Yes.
We stop ourselves and we end up being in quicksand and cement and not living the way God would have us to live and saying what happened to me 10 years ago was all I can take. And what happened 15 years ago is all I can take. I'm just going to coast myself on out. I tell you right now, you got to keep on living.
Amen.
And there's no use in trying to figure out when this earthly life is going to be over. It's no use in trying to guesstimate when is your last day. Because there's some folks that last day might be at 26, and some folks last day might be at 105. But I tell you, you don't know. So what do? You keep on living. You keep on blessing folks, and you keep on saying the praises of God. She opened up her home to this man, Elisha. And it's amazing that she didn't ask for anything, but he felt compelled because she had been so kind to him that I ought to do something for you. See, a lot of folks need that lesson right now. You can keep on doing all types of stuff for folks and they never ask, what can I do in exchange? Is there anything I can help you with? Is there anything you need? When they see you coming, they just say, hallelujah, I'm going to get blessed again. Elijah says, is there something that I can do for you? And she says, notice how she is so confident and firm in who she is as a woman. Notice what the text says. Let me get down there just so I can make sure you don't miss it. Oh, Lord, I had it right here. I'll tell you what it says. You look at yourself in the Bible. She says, I live among my own people. What is that saying to us? It's saying to us, Sister Cora, she says, I know you want to help me, but I'm doing just fine. I got my own money. I got my own house. I got my own man. I'm just trying to help you because that is the thing to do. Well, it happens that he finds out that she doesn't have any children, so he says to her, by this time next year, you will have a son. But notice in the text where she says, no, verse 16, no, my Lord, O man of God, do not lie to your maidservant. That reminds us that she says, don't start making promises that you can't keep. Don't start promising me things that you don't have any ability to give because I've been through too much. I've dealt with too much. I've dealt with too much. There's been too much disappointment. There's been too many tears. There's been too much pain for you to come here now, Elijah, and tell me that you want to do something that we haven't been able to do for ourselves. Don't lie to me. Lo and behold, she has a baby. Hallelujah. Has anyone ever been in that space? You weren't sure if your blessing could ever get here. And then all of a sudden you had a baby. And I'm not just talking about babies in the sense of babies of children, but you birthed something that you weren't sure you could birth anymore. The Lord called you to the gospel ministry and you said, who, me? The Lord called you to be a deacon and you said, I'm not sure. You said the Lord called you to a life of holiness and separate, and you said, oh, Lord, I can't do it. And then one day, all of a sudden, Brother Will, it happened. You birthed this new life that God has given you, and you begin to praise God. But as soon as the blessing gets here, you are prepared for those who will come against you.
Amen.
I believe the day's going to be May the 21st. We are going to ordain a new set of diaconate. Brother Jason Wingard and his wife, Sister Gingy Wingard, and Brother David Pearson will come into the diaconate, into the fold. And I might as well tell you this before May the 21st, that when you take a step forward for God, then Satan is getting ready to put his arrow and his bullseye right on you. You thought it was bad before, get ready for what comes next. Because now you're saying, here I am. I'm stepping forward and this is who I will be. And so I'm warning you now. I'm explaining it to you now, but this is what I say, just keep on persisting. Yes. It's going to come about this year that we're going to license Sister Jody to preach the gospel. Yes. And we've been meeting with her and talking with her and getting her ready. And I was sharing with her what I'm telling you right now. When you take a step forward for God, get ready for, there's going to be those who will try to tear you down. Yes. For no other reason than they want to tear down the glory of Jesus Christ. Yes. You've been warned. Yes. You've been given an explanation. Nevertheless, I expect you to persist in doing what the Lord has said to do. Later on this year, we're going to ordain Minister Demetra Smith to the gospel ministry. She's been appointed and prepared, and now she's taking this next step. And I tell you, Minister Smith, there are those who are going to look at you and say, who do you think you are? And they're going to add it up to the song, Mrs. Big Stuff. And then they're going to wonder who you are when you start preaching and sharing the glory of God. You've been warned. I've given you the explanation. Now I firmly expect you to persist in what God has told you to do. Brothers and sisters in Christ, when you came forward and came to receive Jesus, there were those who looked at you like, who do you think you are? I knew you when, I knew you what, and I remember when you used to do all these different things. I remember when you used to work at the chicken joint. I remember when you used to hang with me on the... They don't know this. I may not say the names, but I use real stories. These are real testimonies about how God has blessed someone else. You've been warned. I'll give you the explanation. I firmly expect you to persist. Well, she had a baby, and the baby got grown, and you know how it is. You see your children getting big. I look at some of the kids now. I see young Michael back there looking like a grown man, amen? Everybody looking at Michael. Say hi, Michael.
Hi.
Amen. She got to build him up when he goes to school tomorrow. It made him feel good that we said hi to him today, amen? Here is the space, and all of a sudden, the boy drops dead. But she persisted in believing God. Look at what the text said, verse 23. She finds herself, she goes and she's going to see the man of God. And he said, why will you go to him today? It is neither new moon nor Sabbath. And she said, it will be well. Everyone say, it will be well. You got to speak to some things in your life before it turns around. You got to say what it is that you want it to be, even though it looks like it's something different. Look at what the woman says. It will be well. I know my boy is dead and he's up on the bed of the prophet. I know I shut the door and nobody can get in. I know that my husband is trying to talk me out of it. Look at what the text says. I didn't make it up. Look at what the text says. When she gets ready to go to see the prophet about her dead boy, look at what happens. He says, why are you going today? Oh, that's some of us right now. You know it's the truth. You get ready to leave out the house and he looks at you. Why are you going today? You get ready to put your tie on and she looks at you. You going again? You get ready to go on to church and the friends say, why are you going home so early? They try to talk you out of what you know to be the right thing to do. What you know God has called us to do. What you know God has ordained for us to be. What you know God is saying, I want you all of you right now, every day, 24/7, 365 of the year. Don't let somebody that's on their way to hell talk you out of their place. Shame you out of the blessings of God. Try to convince you that you're less. Teenagers, hear me now. Don't let them try to convince you that you're less than, because they don't understand the blessing in your life. It will be well. I want you to notice the change, though. Her faith grew as she started traveling. See, you got to start, when you take steps with God, First step, second step, third step. You gain strength and courage as you walk along. Look at the change in the text. So in verse 23, she says, it will be well. In verse 26, she says, it is well. As she got to walking to the prophet, her faith began to grow. As you start walking with the Lord, your faith begins to grow. See, because after God has done one thing for you, that gives you a prior understanding that God can do the second thing for you. See, if you've never woken up before, you don't know what it is to wake up. But when you wake up one day, you expect to wake up the next. When the Lord blesses you in one way, you are able to see that God can bless you again. What's the song say? If he did it before, he'll do it again. It gives us an understanding that God is able. Well, I know at least we got the thing, right? At least I'm going to try and get you out. Reception, new members. Well, shush. Receive this. It is well. Well, you realize that as you move along, you have to hold fast to the faith that God has given you.
Yes.
You have to shun those who would seek to bring you down.
Yes.
But the last thing I'll leave you with, Brother Willie, is prepare yourself for the miraculous.
Amen.
Amen.
Prepare yourself for the miraculous.
Right.
See, miracles are those things that happen that you can't explain. If you were there at Lazarus' tomb and a mummy starts walking out, you realize Jesus really is who he said he is. If you were there on the Sea of Galilee and you got feet just like Peter, but Peter's walking on the water and you're still in the boat, you're saying Jesus must be who he said he really is. If you were there during that death processional and they carrying the boy and Jesus stopped and touched the boy and the boy got up in the midst of his own funeral, you would say that Jesus is who he truly is. The miracle of God. The miracle that he can do things that we can't even explain. Well, I can tell you the rest of the story. You just have to believe me that it's in the Bible or read it yourself. Amen?
Yeah.
I've read it plenty of times. I want you to read the story. Well, it just so happens that this takes place. The woman gets to Elisha. And Elisha first says, I'm going to send you my staff. And Gehazi, when you get to the dead boy up in the room that I sleep in, where the door is closed, put the rod on the boy's head and see what happens. Well, Gehazi does that, but the boy doesn't move. See, there's some things in our lives that's not going to move on the first time. It needs a little more dose of power. Oh, hallelujah. You remember what happened with the disciples? They said, well, Jesus, how come we couldn't do it? He said, this time. Everyone say this type. This type only comes by from prayer and fasting. There's some things that you gotta take a little more time with.
Amen.
Oh, anybody with children know that? There's some children you gotta take a little more time with. Some children learn faster than others, even in their own house. See, I was the one who they had to explain it to me a few times. Sometimes I didn't get it on the first time around. Well, it just so happened that Elijah gets there, and this is the miracle. You prepare yourself for the miraculous. He goes down to where the boy is, and see what the text says. It says he lies on top of the boy, his mouth to his mouth, and his heart to his heart, his breath to his breath, and he lays there, and all of a sudden, someone starts sneezing. Seven times the boy started sneezing, and all of a sudden it says his body got warm. And all of a sudden, as the body gets warm and he starts sneezing seven times, it says that the boy gets up, the woman walks in and she realizes her boy is alive again. She has prepared herself for the miraculous, because before he was alive, she said, it will be well. And before he got up, she said, it is well. So she believed that God was able to do what he believed that God said he can do. And that is to do the miraculous that no one else can explain. I tell you right now, when you start walking for God and talking for God and living for God, they're going to warn you.
They're going to say, Linda, they're not going to like you. Lisa, they're going to say all manner of evil against you, Ayanna. But I tell you, you've been warned. And when they give you the explanation about who they say you ought to be, just listen to them. But you remember what the woman did in the Senate. You remember what those women did that I talked about earlier. And you make sure that nevertheless, you persist in what God has called you to do. Don't stop now. Don't stop tomorrow. Don't stop ever, because what God has started in you, he will surely bring to pass. You don't give in when it gets nervous. You don't give in at the first sign of trouble. You just hold on.
You build your hopes on things that are eternal, and you just hold the gods on his unchanging hand, because time is filled with swift transition. You just hold on to God's unchanging hand. I trust that blessed you today, because it blessed me while I was sharing with you. Because it can be tempting to turn around if you don't get as many people to the Spark Conference as you want to, Jalen. But you nevertheless, you keep on persisting. It may not be all that you want to be at every doctor's appointment, but I tell you, you keep on. You keep on persisting. It may not be all that you wanted to be every time that you wanted to be, but I tell you, you've been warned and you've been given an explanation, but we decided that we've started with God a long time ago and we know too much about him to turn back now. He will keep on making a way. He will keep on breaking the yoke. He will keep on breaking the chains. He will keep on giving us the light in the midst of darkness. God is a God who is not like man. He doesn't know how to tell a lie. And I tell you, if he said it, then it will happen. You just have to believe it. Oh, Lord Jesus. Y'all stand up. If you don't know Jesus Christ, I invite you to come. If you're not a member of a local church, I invite you to come. If you want someone to pray with you, I invite you to come. God is still able to do exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask or think. The deacons are here. They're going to smile at you. Smile, deacons.